We actually closed the door, thank you, Chris.
That's what you marked the back for.
I'm not trying to make trouble, but I think we sort of need to not have the noise going in there, vice versa. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Liz Krueger, Chair of the Finance Committee. I'm joined by my colleague Senator Seward, Ranker for the Finance Committee. As I just said before the camera started rolling, we're competing with the Judiciary Committee next door, and there's quite a bit of overlap between membership on the two committees. We do have ANF voting sheets to have the meeting, even though it looks like the non-senators outnumber the senators significantly this morning. We're joined by Senator Gustavo Rivera, Senator Brian Benjamin, Senator Ranzenhofer. Thank you. I've been practicing. Okay, fine. And our first order of business. Oh, I said Senator Seward. Sorry, I announced him first. Senator Seward.
Thank you.
We're going to start off with three confirmations that are in your packet, but we have not required them to attend the meeting. These are Brigadier Generals who are co-appointed by the federal government and the state government for these specific positions, and they are funded through the federal government. So it's the tradition of this Finance Committee not to require them to appear. And Allison, why don't you read off each of them?
We're going to consider Brigadier General Thomas John Owens II for promotion to the grade of Major General, New York Air National Guard. Also, Brigadier General Greg A. Semmel for promotion to the grade of Major General, New York Air National Guard. And Brigadier General Timothy J. LaBarge for promotion to the grade of Major General, New York Air National Guard.
Any discussion? Yes, please.
I would just say that I have reviewed the qualifications of these three individuals, and they are truly worthy of this promotion. No question.
Senator Kennedy's joining us. I agree, we reviewed their paperwork, and turns out when you're a Major General, you come through with a great deal of vetting paperwork. So I share my colleague's view that there is absolutely no reason why we wouldn't want to ensure that these three gentlemen are in their positions serving us here in their joint federal-state positions. We've also been joined by Senator Jamal Bailey. We almost were joined by Senator Lunardis, but he walked in and walked out again. Okay, so all those in favor? Aye. Any no, any without rec? The three nominees are moved to the floor for confirmation. Thank you. I did say hello to Senator Kennedy when he came in, yes.
Making sure no one's coming.
Yes, thank you. Okay, let's start with the bills, Allison.
Senate 178 by Senator Helming, an act to direct the Office of Fire Prevention and Control to conduct a study which evaluates the minimum recommended qualifications to becoming a volunteer firefighter.
Any discussion? Any motion?
I would move the bill.
Senator Seward is moving the bill. Senator Gustavo Rivera seconding the bill. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 709 by Senator Boyle, an act establishing a temporary state commission to study and make recommendations on the effectiveness of the Amber Alert system.
Any discussion? Motion by Brian Benjamin, motion by Senator Seward, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? Okay, the bill moves to the floor.
Senate 741 by Senator Montgomery, an act to amend the executive law and the criminal procedure law in relation to directing the superintendent of state police to develop and institute child-sensitive arrest policies.
Any discussion?
Move the bill.
I just had a couple quick thoughts here. I understand the intent here. It is too bad the sponsor is not here this morning. I'm just looking for sort of a for instance of how this could be accomplished. For the safety of our police officers. I mean, these are very difficult situations, no question about it. And when there are children in the household or present during an arrest, that can be traumatic. I understand that. But that would strike me that existing policy would call for the bringing in the social services, child protective units, to deal with a child in these situations. I'm going to go eye without rec on the bill because I just have a number of these questions on the legislation.
So you're certainly welcome to go eye without rec, but I know when I reviewed the bill, what this bill does is bring together the Municipal Police Training Council to establish best practices. So it's actually police themselves working with the other appropriate agencies to literally compare notes and come up with a best practice procedure for handling these situations, which I think can only be a win-win, in fact, for the children and for the police when dealing with an arrest, because as the memo to the bill highlights, these are both procedures for how to handle children in the home if the parent or guardian is being arrested, as well as how to handle children if they are being arrested, and making sure, as you said, that child services is being called in, or other community-based providers who have an appropriate role in the family situation. So again, it's not us mandating this is what the police must do, but creating an entity that includes the police, DCJS, Office of Children and Family Services, to work together to come up with best practice with this Division of State Police as well. So I understand, raising concerns, but I think this tries to do exactly what you want.
Just one additional question or point, and that is, are there any sanctions against the arresting police officers if a situation deteriorates to the point where these procedures are not able to be followed? I mean, if a situation escalates to the point where it wouldn't be appropriate to perform these, carry out these procedures, are there any sanctions against that police officer, or would this open up any action against that police officer?
I'm turning to our counsel, who is shaking her head.
No, the bill doesn't establish any sanctions. That would be left up to DCJS, state police, and the coalition that would be instituting these policies.
Other discussion? Motion to move the bill? Senator Bailey, Senator Rivera, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Without rec, Senator Seward. The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 1228 by Senator Ritchie is being held at the request of the sponsor. So we're going to move on to Senate 1544 by Senator Kennedy, an act to amend the public health law and Chapter 802 of the laws of 1947 relating to facilitating the financing and effectuation of air terminals by the Port of New York Authority.
Any discussion? And no questions for Senator Kennedy. Move the bill, Senator Rivera. Seconded, Senator Benjamin. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Any without rec?
I'm without rec.
Senator Seward without rec. The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 1650 by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the civil rights law in relation to requiring places of public accommodation, resort, or amusement that operate televisions during regular hours of operation to provide closed captioning on certain televisions upon request.
Any discussion?
Move the bill.
Second.
We have a motion by Brian Benjamin, a second by Senator Kennedy. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Any without rec?
I'm without rec on this bill.
Senator Seward without rec.
Senate 1821 by Senator Rivera, an act to amend the social services law in relation to including applied behavioral analysis for treatment of autism spectrum disorder.
Any discussion? Senator Stewart?
Yes. Is there a cost estimate in terms of what this bill if enacted would cost in terms of the physical implications?
Senator Rivera is the sponsor, so he's reviewing. But was this a proposal within the budget?
Hi.
Thank you.
So it was presented to be $6.4 million for this year, and it was included within the budget.
$6.4 million?
Yeah.
You say those funds are included in the budget?
Yes.
To cover the implementation?
Yes.
See, right.
Brilliant response.
Yes, it was.
Further discussion or questions?
Move
Senator Rivera looks forward to answering your question.
Yeah. Well, just as a follow-up to that excellent response from staff and Senator Rivera, is there language in the budget in terms of implementing this? I mean, is that 6.4 tied to this, and is there implementing?
So it's included.
Language in the budget?
It's included in Part B, Subpart A, as an additional benefit. I believe this bill specifically outlines, and this is what we were pointing to when we enacted this in the budget.
Yeah.
Would you like to respond?
Simply by saying I'm going aye without record.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Senator McKinney, second. Senator Bailey, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And Senator Seward without record.
Yes.
Thank you.
Senate 2690 by Senator Sepulveda, an act to amend the correction law in relation to inmates with a serious mental illness.
Any discussion? Discussion first.
I just had a question regarding the difference between in terms of someone being classified as a person with a serious mental illness. Does that designation, what does that designation provide in terms of, are we talking about extra services here or accommodations?
Chris Alexander would like to answer your question.
So first on the definition, the mental hygiene definition is a bit more expansive. It includes designations, clinical diagnoses made by practitioners as opposed to the enumerated list that's listed here. Particularly in terms of impact and access to services, the SHU exclusion law that the legislature passed in 2008, that was enacted in 2011, provided an exclusion for people with serious mental illnesses from being placed into segregated confinement. Currently, a large portion of the incarcerated population are not eligible for that diversion into separate units. This would expand the impact and ensure that the SHU exclusion law is actually excluding folks who have serious mental issues.
And who makes that determination?
DOC's facility, they designate folks.
No further questions.
Okay. Now, motion to move the bill. Senator Kennedy, Senator Bailey, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Without rec.
Without rec, aye.
Senator Seward.
I'm not recommending much today.
That's all right. Okay, that moves to the floor. Next bill.
Senate 3404 by Senator Stewart Cousins, an act to amend Chapter 504 of the laws of 2016, amending the tax law relating to authorizing the town of Greenberg to adopt a local law to impose a hotel-motel occupancy tax.
And does this have a home rule message?
That's a great question.
Move the bill.
Is there any other discussion? I'm sorry? Yes. It doesn't require a home rule, or just
not in our house.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Well, I'll ask the question again before it comes to the floor, just to make sure. So I heard any discussion? Motion, Senator Rivera, seconded by Senator Kennedy. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Without rec.
I'm going to be consistent. I'm going to recommend this.
Okay. Sorry, Allison. Salazar.
Okay. Senate 3427 by Senator Salazar, an act to amend the state finance law in relation to arbitration provisions in state contracts.
I'm sorry, first I have to ask discussion. Senator, do you have any questions? Okay. Now we can move the bill, seconded by Senator Benjamin. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And are we without rec?
I'm without rec.
Senator continues his streak of without rec for Senator Seward. Okay. Senate to the floor.
Senate 3465 by Senator Biaggi, an act to amend the social services law in relation to employee human trafficking recognition training.
Any discussion?
Yes, I had a question regarding this. In terms of, are there any costs identified in terms of what this would cost for the, all of this training? You're going to have drivers that, or those that work for public transportation services are going to be going through this training if this bill became law. And are there any costs associated with it?
Anyone?
And who would pick up those costs?
John, is that you?
Yes. Senator, we envision an online delivery model for the training. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security and several nonprofit agencies have robust training materials on human trafficking available online. So we envision the state agencies just identifying which of those to use and then having an online delivery system. So we're not envisioning an in-person training or anything of that nature. So it would be minimal cost impact.
Let's come up with a for instance. If someone has gone through the training and there was a situation where they may have missed a circumstance where there was a human trafficking incident going on their bus or whatever the mode of transportation is. Would this open up the lawsuits against the employee or their entity that they're employed by if they in fact miss a human trafficking situation after they've gone through the training?
We don't
need kind of indemnifying language here.
There's no indemnifying language, Senator, but the bill does not impose any duty to act on any of the transportation employees. It merely requires that they receive the training and how to recognize human trafficking. But it doesn't impose any duty on their part to actually act in the incident and in an instance of suspected human trafficking. But there is no specific indemnity clause either.
So there's no duty to report?
No, not imposed by the law.
It's not a mandatory reporting bill, it's a mandatory training
correct.
Of people who work in these fields.
Interesting.
Any other discussion?
Chairman, I'm sorry. I made this earlier in our conversation because
we are on.
I know the bill,
okay.
But I'm just wondering about again. This may be covered. Yeah. I'm going to be the meeting, public transportation service. So the way I envision that is, say, the MTA and the Federal State Transportation Authority. This also apply to the school district that provides public transportation. That the public transportation may have to undergo this type of training. Public transportation in the sense that.
So will school bus drivers be covered? So you mean,
right.
Would they be covered under this bill?
They are not specifically included, Senator, but the specific employees to be covered would be developed by the agencies when they're developing and implementing the program. But school bus drivers are not specifically covered.
Is anybody specifically listed in the bill?
It would be including but not limited to rail passenger service, motor bus, regular route service, paratransit service, motor bus charter service, and ferry passenger service. And it's applicable to customer facing employees, not all employees. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. I got a follow up question.
Certainly, Senator.
Particularly in the upstate region, Amtrak, which is a federal entity. Amtrak provides the bulk of the rail passenger service. Are they covered? Is Amtrak covered?
As a federal rail service, Senator, I don't know necessarily that we would have the jurisdiction to require it of them, but I do know that there are many employees, particularly in certain, in public transit areas specifically, that already receive this training, and the bill is more intended to extend it to the private sector transportation services. Many public transportation employees already receive some form of the trafficking recognition. So this bill is envisioned more to bring that into the private sector.
Is there a protocol right now for this type of training? Is it a 6-week program, a 36-week program?
Senator, there's multiple resources that are available online that are already currently available. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security and numerous nonprofit agencies have various training modules that are available online. We're talking a matter of hours to review the materials. It's not anything.
So it's online training then, right?
Correct. Okay, correct. That's what we're using.
Any other discussion? A motion? Senator Kennedy moves. Senator Benjamin seconds. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? Senator Reisenhofer, Senator Seward without rec. The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 3548 by Senator Stavisky, an act to amend the state finance law in relation to 5-year capital plans for the State University of New York and the City University of New York.
I'm going to break my record here today, and I'm going to vote yes on this bill and make a motion to move the bill.
Any other discussion? Second. Senator Kennedy seconds after Senator Seward made the motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? The bill moves to the floor, and we've been joined by Senator Little.
Senate 3708 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend Chapter 506 of the laws of 2016, amending the tax law relating to the imposition of an occupancy tax in the town of North Castle.
Any discussion?
It's an extender.
It's an extender, thank you. Any motion? Senator Rivera, Senator Benjamin, first and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay. You came in just in time. Do you want to be without rec?
Tell me what number we're on.
3708. An extender for the town of Newcastle.
I'm a yes.
Okay. All right. The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 4009 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend the education law in relation to allowing polling places for school elections in city school districts of cities with less than 125,000 inhabitants to open at 6 a.m.
Any discussion? Move the bill.
Second.
Betty Little moves the bill. Tim Kennedy seconds the bill. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? Score.
I voted yes.
We all voted yes. It's a winner. Thank you. Next bill.
Senate 4080A by Senator Savino, an act to amend the labor law and the state finance law in relation to requiring the licensing of persons engaged in the design, construction, inspection, maintenance, alteration, and repair of elevators.
Any discussion? Well, I want to say thank you, Senator Savino. I think this was originally my bill. I'm afraid to count how many years ago. I think I probably have more elevators in my district than anywhere else in the state, and I am hopeful that we complete this assignment quickly through both houses.
And I want to thank you, Senator Kruger, for putting it on the agenda today. This bill, as you pointed out, you carried it originally. Senator Boston had carried it. I've carried it. It's been, at one point, we had 52 co-sponsors in the Senate. We are finally going to get it across the finish line. In the period of time that we have been trying to move this bill through, there have been countless number of elevator accidents in the city and state. Have been shocking and tragic in many instances, including deaths in my district and the districts all around the state. And we're finally going to move into that, but making sure that the people who are working in this industry are licensed and they're trained and they're professional, and they are safe as well as the people who are engineers that move so many of us around the state. So thank you. And we're going to get it across the finish line. Finally, this is
all right. I'm sorry, Senator.
They get the perseverance award.
Yes. Absolutely. Any other discussion of the bill?
Second.
Senator Rivera.
Second.
Senator Kennedy, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Negative.
And a without rec? Well, Diane, we'll talk to him afterwards. Okay. We have the votes, it's going to the floor. Thank you.
You have the elevators.
That's right. You don't get a vote, you're right, there's no elevator.
Senate 4347 by Senator Krueger, an act to amend the tax law in relation to limitations on political activity.
Any discussion?
Yeah, I had just a question regarding this. Isn't it already for someone to maintain their tax exempt status? If they cross the line into political activity, don't they, under existing law, lose their exemption?
They're at risk of losing their 501c3. And in fact, in New York State right now, I would say we really have not had any problem with this, but it's actually the not-for-profit organizations, their associations, who've come to us and said, please pass this into law so that if the current federal government decides to change the rules, which they have been flirting with, that we don't find ourselves in a situation where not-for-profits are potentially even pressured to move into political activity that they don't want to be part of. So I'm not sure that there was memos in support in any of your packages. They are floating around with very large number of not-for-profit organizations, statewide umbrella organizations, and also religious organizations who say it would be very dangerous to walk into this territory. We want to make clear in New York State that this isn't going to happen. So to some degree, this is a bill to codify what pretty much already happens in New York, but the organizations we work with in the state don't want to find themselves open to a new problem potentially coming up.
In my thinking, you know, despite what happens or may not happen in Washington, don't in terms of having a tax exempt status here in New York State, isn't there a separate application to the New York State Tax and Finance? I mean, you know, I didn't realize we were connected to whatever the feds do here. We have our own laws here in the state, and applications for tax-exempt status are made at the state level.
So the legal definition of being a nonprofit corporation is actually primarily based on whether you meet IRS 501c3 certification, and then separately, if you are doing business in the state of New York, and you are above a certain size and it's a pretty small threshold, you are supposed to file with the New York State Attorney General's Office of Charitable Institutions. I don't believe there's a separate filing with Tax and Finance in the state. But you supposedly do file with the Charities Bureau. But there's a little gray area where a large religious institution, if they have one 501c3, filed, they don't necessarily need it for each individual church, synagogue, or mosque under their authority, but there's no tax and finance role in this.
So who, what entity makes the determination that a tax-exempt organization has in fact engaged in improper political activity? Who makes that determination?
At this point, it would pretty much be the IRS coming in and determining that. I suppose a complaint could be filed with. Oops. We had an advertising interruption. I suppose that a complaint could be filed with the Attorney General's office of a violation of such in the Charities Bureau. I'm sure there must have been those. I'm just not familiar with any individual storyline.
My final question is, I noticed in the bill that your language that adds, in addition to the political activity and so on, in opposition to any candidate. Does the sponsor have any any, who were you trying to get at with that particular language?
Well, we were trying to make clear that if you're a 501c3 not-for-profit organization, you should not be involved with endorsing for or against any individual political campaign, candidate, or party. Not-for-profits are supposed to not be partisan, not to get involved in political endorsements for or against anyone. They can, of course, speak out on issues. They can educate legislators on issues. There are actually different rules and standards about public education around specific bills, or even using some small percentage of their budget participating in what most of us think of as lobbying for or against a bill. But they have always been explicitly excluded from political endorsements pro or con any given candidate or party. And I think they think that's a good idea, and I actually think that's also a good idea, hence the bill.
You're referring to they.
So the not-for-profit sector. So again, I'm just double checking. I was running from one committee meeting to another, so I want to see if I have my memos package. I have a large memos package. It is possible I have some memos on this. I don't think we found any memos against when we were reviewing. Thank you. Alex is much more efficient than I am. So a memo in support from NICON, which is the New York Council of Not-for-Profits, which represents over 3,000 not-for-profits in New York. That's it. So one memo in support representing 3,000 organizations. Would you like a copy?
I think I have access to it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, Senator Little.
I probably should know the answer to this, but I don't. Are union organizations considered not-for-profit?
They do not fall under 501c3. I don't remember what their C number, C letter is, but it's not
C3.
It
looks like they're clearly C4.
C4?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is specific to C3. Other questions? Senator Ranzenhofer.
Yes, not a question, but a comment.
Yes.
You know, having served on the Corporations and Authorities Committee for a year to deal with not-for-profits, and I find myself in a very unusual situation as being a named sponsor on a bill that you were sponsoring. So it's odd, but this is a good bill because it, you know, it very clearly states that you're not involved in political activity. That's why I support it. That's why I'm a sponsor of it as well. Thank you.
See, by tomorrow, who knows what we're doing together, Senator?
He'll be sitting on our side.
Believe it now. I didn't realize we had sides.
Touche.
I'll teach you when we're on the floor later. I'll show you the aisle.
Senator Bailey.
Just to that point, I was going to say that, speaking of strange vegetables, I like the personal history. I like the cover of the New York Post thing. So. Everything today is on the
list. I'll have to go look.
I'll break things.
It's about this getting these iron wounds. Oh, this drafting, I think I'm on your coupling as well.
All right. I felt it was going to be about sports when you said that. Getting back to this legislation, are there other discussions, issues? May I call for motions? Senator Ranzenhofer, would you like to be the... And Senator Kennedy, because there are not signs?
Sure.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Without rec?
I'm going without rec.
Okay.
I'm not going to choose some.
That's Senator Seward without rec, I believe, is the only other than yes. The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 4521 by Senator Kaplan, an act to amend the retirement and social security law in relation to annual earnings limitations for retired police officers employed as school resource officers.
Discussion?
I would move
yes.
The bill.
Senator Seward would like to move the bill. Senator Ranzenhofer seconds the bill. Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? The bill moves to the floor.
Senate 4575 by Senator May, an act to amend the economic development law in relation to establishing a program to provide education and training to individuals 50 years of age and older.
Any discussion? Senator Little.
Yeah, I'm a no vote on this. I just think there's so many programs out there already. I've read them, we see them advertised, they're promoted by community colleges, free to attend, workforce development has programs like this. And I don't see, despite the fact that I'm over 55, I don't see any reason to separate that age group. I think that one learns from the other. So separate entrepreneur programs are necessary.
So I happened to run a roundtable in Manhattan on Friday morning with experts on employment for older workers. And in fact, there was a great deal of discussion by my my roundtable experts on the importance of ensuring that there is both retraining and workforce development for older people coming back into the workforce. The fact is that they have amazing skills in many areas that employers don't know about, but they also,
yeah. I just think that there are a lot of programs.
Well, so that was actually part of the roundtable. You would have enjoyed it, and the discussion that the legislature might remember that we actually approved $175 million for workforce development in a year ago's budget that has yet to be appropriated or spent. And so the recommendation coming out of my roundtable was discussion with the second floor about important uses of those funds, including programs just like this. So just pointing out that this bill doesn't require a new appropriation, but actually calls for ESDC to draw down on their funds, because apparently ESDC is also now in control of that $175 million for new models of workforce development. So I respectfully disagree. I actually think this is a very important target program given the demographics of the state. But with that, any other discussion?
Second.
First, second, sorry, it was Kennedy, Bailey. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Senator Little opposed. Any without rec? The bill moves. Thank you.
Senate 4653 by Senator Metzger, an act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law in relation to assistance with aggregating, processing, and transporting agricultural products for producers and processors.
Any discussion?
Move
it up. Second. Senator Rasmussen, Senator Kennedy, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? Senator Seward, do you want to do that? Okay. We have a score again. Thank you, Allison.
Senate 4655 by Senator Metzger, an act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law in relation to establishing a one-stop farming hotline.
Any discussion?
Yes, I'm going to support this bill, but I did have a question regarding if you're going to have a hotline which requires staffing, is this going to be a 24-hour, 7-day week operation, so you would need to staff it all of those times? I could not find in the legislation, you know, in terms of what the implementation of this would be and what it would look like and what the cost would be.
Okay. Anyone who was staffing on this?
Yeah, so you're right. The bill doesn't specify, you know, whether the hotline be 24/7 or otherwise, but it'll be done in cooperation with the Cordon Cooperative Extension and with the assumption that as they move forward, they would put those kind of parameters around if it would be 24/7, if it would be 9/5, all those specifications. And the bill is also subject to an appropriation. So that would be part of it as well.
Senator, I know from other bills on other variations on the topic that in some circumstances that have hotlines, but they're not necessarily defined as, you know, it's an emergency at this moment, they do have people online X number of hours a day and then an answering machine that's checked in with for the evenings. I actually don't know farm emergencies particularly well. When I first read the bill, I must admit, my reflex was, oh, I have called the Butterball Hotline on Thanksgiving and found it extremely helpful to save my turkey. But I'm not sure that farmers would view it exactly the same way. But I do, in talking to the sponsor, you know, Cornell Cooperative Extension runs an incredible diversity of programs in support of agriculture. And in fact, this legislature in this house has been strongly supportive of those programs year in, year out. And this would be a mechanism for farmers who aren't necessarily driving up to Ithaca to talk to someone, a one phone number to call to start to get the kind of information that I think Cornell exists to provide them if there's a good match. And so the phone line where somebody would direct you to the right division within Cornell Cooperative Extension, or be able to just answer that question, when do I take the turkey out of the oven, would be quite valuable.
I agree with you. I'm going to support the bill.
Have you used the Butterball Hotline?
I have not.
Okay. Does everyone know about it? You don't have to buy a Butterball turkey. Any turkey. Okay. I'll stop. motion.
This feature is less than
there was?
Butterball Hotline.
Okay. So my guilt on open mic. I didn't learn you're supposed to take the paper bag with the gizzards and things out of the cavity. Hence, your turkey catches fire from inside. A bad thing. Don't do that. Just telling you. Thank you, Kevin. You'll mind. And no doubt you'll have something up online about me immediately, right?
Yes, of course.
Of course you will. I look forward to whatever you find of the burning turkey. Do we have motions? Did somebody say yes to motions? Senator Skubas wants to move this bill.
Second.
And Senator Thomas wants to move this bill. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any without rec? The bill moves. Thank you.
Senate 4809 by Senator Persaud, an act to amend the social services law in relation to any unearned income of a child in certain circumstances.
Any discussion?
Yeah, I had a question regarding this bill.
Yes.
The reference to unearned income of a child, are we talking about dividends and interest?
No, by and large, you're talking about the potential that the child may have SSD, supplemental security income, or some kind of other disability payment. And it's the storyline of it's a grandparent or an aunt or uncle who's caring for that child. They may be public assistance eligible for, but they've agreed to take in the child. And the math formula is unfavorable to them if they have to treat that child as simply an additional member of their PA household, as opposed to letting them be what's called a child-only case, or a freestanding child case who's receiving SSI, which is always intended for the disabled child anyway, not necessarily for the rest of the family. So it allows that flexibility. The people who actually came to the sponsor with their concerns were the groups working on kinship foster care services throughout the state, disproportionately in upstate New York, talking about the dilemmas of they're doing advice to large numbers of family where grandmothers, grandparents had taken in the children. Parents may be deceased from drug overdoses, they might be incarcerated, they just might not have been able to take care of those children. And the dilemma under the existing rules that the grandparents are left so impoverished that trying to address the basic income needs for themselves, whoever was in their household before they took in other kin, is making it impossible for them to survive. So it was heavily the advocacy of the kinship foster care organizations urging us to do this.
It would be my preference to use a different term if the SSI benefits are really what we're getting at. That term, unearned income of a child, I mean, it's, it's hard to imagine, but a child may have, you know, a trust fund or something of that sort. I mean, I think the definitions need to be much tighter in the bill. And also, it does in fact expand the definition of household.
So, I think for memo purposes, it's not a problem. I think I will talk to the sponsor. I think under federal TANF law, they use the definitions of earned and unearned income for household members. John Vito behind me is, I'm not sure we're allowed to change that.
Correct, and it's used throughout the social services laws. It's standard terminology throughout the social services law, and they just talk about federal laws.
But I understand your point. But I would also tell you it's very unlikely that you have a large trust fund and you end up with in a household receiving public assistance. Statistically, probably not that common story. Senator Ratzenhofer.
Thank you. So under the scenario right now, you have a parent, single parent, and a woman, and has a child in the household, and you're a public assistance, and that child is receiving child support. When the parent is receiving child support from the child,
yes.
Is that money in child support, is that considered in whether or not you qualify and how much you get for public assistance?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And the same question, and the child is a recipient of Social Security income, does that money count for the household income?
So for a child to receive Social Security income, I think it would need to be, and I'm looking behind me, SSDI, disability income from the Social Security Administration. They can't get the,
right?
So then they would be defined as disabled under federal law. And I don't remember what the TANF rules are about whether SSDI for the child is counted against the rest of the household or not.
I would have to check.
Yeah, we would check for you. I used to know all this, and now I don't.
Okay, so we can transfer that situation from the worst scenario to where single parent has income, that parent either, for whatever reason, is no longer there, then goes to live with grandparents, uncle, aunt, whoever. It is the intent of the law to say, well, when the child was living in the parent's household, that child support counted towards the public assistance calculation of the public assistance grant. But if you take the parent out, substitute another person, that rule is no longer going to apply, that now it's not going to apply.
Okay, so. Senator Seward is my son. Stop that. I'm the single mom. I'm receiving child support from the father of Senator Seward, and that is being accounted against my public benefits for the two of us now. Then I'm gone for some reason. I went to prison. I died. Child welfare took him away from me. He ends up in a different family member's home. A kinship foster care type model. So the question is, child support would continue from the absentee father? I don't know if it even does continue.
In this scenario, Senator, the child support payment would count against the child. The child would be treated as their own public assistance case separate from the main household. So the child support would count against the child's case, but not the larger.
In the first scenario with the mother, or the second scenario with the grandparent?
With the mother, it's always the child must be counted with the mother as one case, and the child support gets counted against.
Right.
In a different family member who takes
over. Grandmother. Saying that now we're going to have a new system where that money coming into the household no longer counts.
Senator, it's not actually a new system. It's making more clear what's currently allowable through TANF rules. There are certain social services districts in the state that are actually aware that the cases can be processed in this manner, and they do it, and the families are able to receive the benefit that they're entitled to. In a lot of the social services districts across the state, they're simply not aware. They enter the case incorrectly. So the intent of the bill is to just make more clear that this is how to proceed in these instances, so that the families and the children in particular are getting the benefit that they're currently entitled to.
And I also just want to clarify something overall. If the child is on public assistance and there's child support coming through for them, they don't actually get the money. The state gets the money directly, subtracts that from the public assistance, and passes only a $50 pass-through to the family. It's still $50,
right?
Counts.
Counts in the calculation.
Right. So it's not that they're getting a boondoggle anyway because they get child support. It's simply, it's reimbursing the county, so there's not a big dollar difference to the family.
So do I understand correctly that this bill is not enacting new legislation? What I heard said is that the law is as it is right now. This bill doesn't change any law. This is like a notice saying that there's already existing law, but we're going to pass a law to let other. Why wouldn't we just send a notice to agencies saying, hey, this is the law? Why are we passing a law which doesn't change the law? And secondly, I thought this bill, bear with me. And normally when we look at these bills, you know, we have deleted language in the underlying language that says that we are changing law. So there are things that are underlined here.
I think it does change law, so I'm...
That's why I'm confused, because right. You know, staff is saying that the law as it exists right now is not changing at all. This is just kind of like notifying folks that there's a law in place. So that's... But then I see language appears to change the law, so I'm just trying to get...
I think it does change the law.
We're making the statute more reflective of what the federal law and the federal rules governing TANF already allow. Those rules and federal policies were not specifically carried over into state social services law, and that's what the bill is looking to do.
So TANF is a federal program that always had a laundry list of options that states could take, and different states have taken different options at different times. So I think the confusion, and I apologize for that, is that federal law allows this. Many localities do this. This would be New York State changing its social service law to reflect that option within federal TANF law.
Okay, so back to the original question, is this then now creating a new way? So the hospital is calculated when you, as mom over there, is, you know, there's a calculation and your household gets a certain amount. If you're not there, it goes to a different person. Now a different system or a calculation of how that money was calculated when the child was in your household. Now it's not in your household, so it's going to be calculated in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Motion to move this bill?
So moved.
Senator Thomas. Senator Montgomery, I know you want a second. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Senator Reisenhofer. Senator Seward. All those without rec? The bill moves to the floor. Thank you.
Senate 5049 by Senator Comrie, an act to amend the public authorities law in relation to exempting mass transit authorities from bond issuance charges.
Any discussion?
Yes, a question,
Senator.
Regarding, will this create an additional cost to the state? And if so, it would be much more appropriate to do this in the context of the budget.
So, Senator,
specifically in this upcoming fiscal year, there won't be a cost, because during the budget, the executive committed to actually waiving any charges. And going forward, the executive does periodically waive these. as they come up. It's usually with the MTA as they come up. So historically, it's a little bit hard to tell if there will be a cost because it's all dependent on the potential size of any bonding that gets done. But for most of the authorities in the state, they actually don't do transportation bonding. They're small enough that they don't. So we don't think that there would be an additional cost.
Did you say that there's language in the budget that waives?
As part of the discussion, talking about the MTA reform, we don't have language lined out in the MTA reform. Is talking about that. But as the need comes up, whether the MTA chooses to add bond for particular things, as they do, the charges we anticipate will be waived in the next fiscal year if they go ahead and do bonding.
Right. So the governor has the authority to waive, and he waived apparently in 2012 and 13, and in many years, in the 15 years preceding 2017. But it is true that in statute we can't charge these fees to other bonding by major authorities, and it's just the MTA left, I think, where we can charge them. Is that right?
I think the bond issuance charge is applicable to a range of authorities. The bond issuance charge is applicable to a range of public authorities. I think what, as David was indicating, the executive has the ability to, in statute, to provide a waiver through an administrative process. And in this year's budget negotiations, because of the investments and the resource needs for the MTA, the executive committed that they would grant that waiver administratively to any transportation bond issuances this year. So to Senator Seward's question, application of this statute would not create any revenue loss for the 1920 fiscal year because that's already been accommodated or assumed in the financial plan.
Is that just for the MTA or for all transportation services?
So that, for the upcoming fiscal year, it's already been accounted for. It's just the MTA. However, the other authorities typically don't have these charges incurred. The other transportation authorities, I should say, because they just traditionally don't do a ton of bonding. So this would say, if they do incur something, it would be waived. This had been done for Rochester, Genesee, Niagara Frontier in the past. Bills had looked at doing this. So it would essentially just take all those transportation authorities, do it at once rather than one authority at a time.
Yes, yeah, so for years, there have been bills, some of which I have sponsored, to waive the bond issue charges on the Niagara Transportation Authority and the Greater Rochester Transportation Authority because they do, in fact, bond and they do incur fees, not to the extent of the MTAs. And it's very disconcerting that the government has waived those charges for New York City, but not for instance, the MTA or either Rochester. So it's a little disconcerting to hear that in this particular budget that he is going to waive the ones for New York City only. And the big plan is, unless you're there, to do significant capital improvements. To take care of New York City on its bond issue charge, it's not going to take care of us in Europe, especially when year after year after year, this body passed legislation unanimously, whether it be for the MTA, whether it be for NFTA, whether it be for Capital District, whether it be for the Greater Rochester. So, I'm going to support the bill because, for the first time, there's something that's included Western New York. Western New York, but it is very disconcerting to hear that the governor decided to take care of the city and not Senator Kennedy's in my area or right. Rochester.
Right. And I'm looking at the notes I received, which included that the four non-MTA authorities all support this legislation.
Pardon?
The non-MTA transportation authorities, including NFTA, RGRTA, and the other two, all support this bill.
Right, because we passed standalone bills
right.
in the past.
Right.
So, no, absolutely.
So, okay. So that's, I think you're arguing for exactly why we should
do this. Yes, absolutely.
Thank you, Senator Ratzenhofer. Other Discussion?
I'll move the bill.
Senator Ranzenhofer moves the bill. Senator Kennedy, it's a transportation bill. Would you like to move
the
bill? Okay, Senator Kennedy joins you. All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Any without rat? The bill moves to the floor. Thank you.
Senate 5129 by Senator Myrie, an act to amend the election law in relation to instituting additional ballot accountability practices.
Any discussion? Okay.
I had a question regarding this. Does this bill do away with the, you know, when you show up to vote, you know, they tear off your ballot, there's a number, you know, that's assigned to you in terms of a voter number,
mm-hmm.
which is a, indicates the number of voters who have showed up in that particular precinct.
Yes.
Does this do away with that that number system? If so, I don't understand why. I mean, it does provide a sense of security and, shall we say, inventory control in terms of ballots in any given precinct.
So my understanding is twofold, and there may be staff here who can do a better job than me, and then they'll jump in. We want to get rid of the tear-off stub because a problem that has been discovered is that when there are rough edges on the ballot, when you try to move it through the scanning machines get choked up. And so you want to avoid the tear-off perforation issue. Second is, there is more and more movement to print ballot on demand, not have them all prepared in advance, because they vary so much and there's waste. So that if you're going to voter shows up, verifies that they're eligible to vote in that precinct, ADED, give them, print out the correct ballot for them, hand it to them, have them fill it in and scan it, that there's not the necessity for tracking how many loose ballots were there floating around, that there's not verification that they were used by a specific voter through this stub system. Jackie, do you want to add to that?
I want to say the bill also requires State Board of Elections to institute new accountability process that would account for the number of each stop ballot, similar to what the old ballot numbers used to do. It would verify and close the polls, the number of ballots distributed. So the State Board of Elections is going to, if this bill is passed, put in accountability procedures that mirrored what was done with the ballot numbers, but don't necessarily need the new ballot numbers. So the protections will still be in place.
Okay, I'm going to go aye without rec because I want to have an opportunity to really examine just what this change would mean. My main concern is you know, security of ballots cast, inventory control in terms of the ballots that may be kicking around in any precinct.
Okay. Any other discussion? Any motions? Senator Skoufis, would you like to motion? Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Senator Montgomery. Seconds. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Any without rec? Senator Seward without rec. The bill moves. And the last bill on today's calendar?
Senate 5155 by Senator Brooks, an act to amend the executive law in relation to statements by charities.
Any discussion? Thank you, Senator Montgomery. Senator Skoufis seconds. All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Any without rec? Senator Seward is without rec. The bill moves to the floor.
Yes.
That completes today's Finance Committee meeting. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Senator Seward.
Yeah.